A flickering to start my talk off. Hello again, I'm Markus Huber. I'm with the St. Pölten University of Applied Sciences, where I started this year. I'm trying to establish research into privacy there. And the talk today is about trackers and how to get rid of them. So, yeah, that's I think our mission as privacy people, trackers, we should get rid of them. Yeah, it's like, and in this talk, I show you some research on how you can effectively block trackers, and also another project I'm working on where we try to make this tracker blocking protection a little bit more usable. First off, and I don't know how many of you have seen the talk on privacy badger. Anybody on the first day? Yeah, a few hands. I was obviously, because I'm very obsessed by the topic, I went there and watched it. And this is also why I'm only briefly speaking about the threats of online tracking to start off my talk. I mean, this picture is the classic, and I mean, you see it in you saw it 10 years ago in presentations, and it's this old cartoon from the New York Times, and on the internet nobody knows you're a dog, and obviously 20 years later this is not true at all. So what I'm going to do is, like, in my future talks, this is going to be the new cartoon I will use for all my presentations on tracking, I think, and privacy on the internet. By the tech of joy, or the joy of tech, it's really cool. I think it summarizes the whole tracking problem pretty well. So in the old days, you were reading your newspaper at home in front of your chimney, and you were happy, and nobody was watching you. Nowadays, when you browse the web, it's like you're reading the news online. It's like Facebook is tracking you, the articles you're reading. The NSA might track what you are reading. Google obviously tracks the whole ecosystem. So you're leaking a lot of personal information nowadays when you surf the web. I think the literally sickest example for this online tracking is from Austria this year. So Austria, the country I'm coming from. This is a translation by the guy into English. Maybe it's not obvious to you, but the story behind this is Daniel Knapp, a fellow Austrian, unfortunately got cancer, and he started Googling his symptoms and his diagnosis, and he ended up getting advertisement for funerals by Facebook. Yeah, so this is, I think, as sick as he can get. Yeah, so he was targeted for funerals. Yeah, you see this here, Bestattung in Wien. Yeah, so I think this is the most epic fail with targeted advertisement. Yeah? The other thing, except from companies like Facebook or advertising companies tracking your online behavior, it's also governmental organizations. Yeah? So what we learned recently through the Snowden disclosures is that the NSA luckily picks up tracking cookies. So they are basically piggybacking on all the tracking advertising companies too. Because they have selectors, and it's very nice for them. So they have these unique identities created by advertising companies and social networks, which uniquely identify you. So one thing they used it for was to reveal the identity of Tor users. So this is a very special case. This is for people who use their browser both for surfing normally in the internet and then use some kind of hack or a Tor proxy to access Tor. So they can basically just link the advertising cookies and they know exactly who you are, no matter if you're using Tor or not. The other thing is they use it for target selection. So they are listening to this huge stream of data and they want to attack this sysadmin at this company or somebody at Belgacom. They want to target the very exact person they want to exploit. And this is where tracking is very handy for them. Yeah, so they also piggybacked on mobile tracking. Yeah, so things leaking through mobile smartphone apps. Yeah, so I think this is like the biggest threats with tracking nowadays. Companies making profiles about your what you serve online, about your medical history and so on, and governmental organizations on the other hand. And the second part of my talk focuses, gives some insights into this arms race between trackers and blockers. Yeah? So, because you didn't, I mean, I'm going to talk about these extensions later on. I think what's the most effective defense at the moment are browser extensions. There are so many of them. So this is, those are the most popular ones. I don't know, I guess most of you use some of the blockers on this list, and I will go into detail about them in the next few slides. Yeah. So the most popular one is AdBlock Plus, and we see that a number of extensions are basically building on the filter rules of AdBlock Plus. And then we have Ghostery, which is very popular, and a newer browser extension, which I quite like, is uBlock, and then Privacy Badger. So I will, because not so many people maybe saw the talk, I will explain Privacy Badger in a few sentences as well. So this is, and we see that it's like AdBlock Plus is used by 20 million people. So this is a really widespread use of such a protection measure. The thing though with AdBlock Plus is their rule set is pretty good. The controversial thing they started in 2012 was this acceptable ads program. So they have some agreements with certain companies, including Google and Amazon, to not block their tracking code or their advertisement. Yeah. So basically, if you're using AdBlock Plus and you are not aware of this, opt out of this feature. Yeah. So wherever you've installed it, just remove the acceptable ads. AdBlock is very similar to AdBlock Plus. It basically just filled the gap for Chrome because the AdBlock Plus people were too slow to port the extension there. uBlock, as I said, is a new browser extension which builds on some of the rule sets of AdBlock Plus, such as Easy List, Easy Privacy, and also a DNS list, which I quite like, by Peter Lowe. And so there are no acceptable ads, and the focus is on performance and privacy. And it's all open source on GitHub. So this is an extension I would highly recommend you. Yeah. The other thing is extensions. So the first ones were all focusing on advertising. Other blocking tools are dedicated to blocking trackers. Yeah. So maybe the most popular one is Ghostery. How many people here have Ghostery installed? Yes, a lot of people. The thing is, Ghostery for us, it works pretty well. For the layperson, the problem is you have to opt into blocking. Yeah. So some people just install the extension, it shows these nice little bubbles about trackers, but you're not actually blocking them. I guess everyone sitting in this stamp already did this. So just as a word of caution. The other thing is Disconnect Me, which is very similar to Ghostery, and it's also included in Firefox right now. So this is an optional feature in Firefox, a built-in tracker blocker, which you can enable. And Privacy Badger, the really nice thing is, and I suggest you to also watch the talk from the first day about Privacy Badger, is it doesn't depend on rule files, so it doesn't download, it doesn't have subscription to rules, but it uses some heuristics to block trackers. Yeah, so it's while you surf, it detects, that's strange. I'm going to all these different websites and I'm always loading content from Google. This might be a tracking domain, so I block it. So Privacy Badger is a really, really nice idea. The thing we as researchers were interested is on how effective are these tools really. Yeah? So, I mean, with Ghostery, you have these little bubbles, or with AdBlock Plus, you just see, okay, the advertisement disappeared, so this seems to be working quite well. But we were interested in how effective they really are. So this is some joint work I've done with Georg Merzdovnik, So Gergner Sofnik is a very gifted programmer who implemented this. And so we crawled 200,000 websites and different subpages of them, so roughly 500 million web requests. And we had automated browsers to analyze the traffic. And we collected the network traffic to see how effective they are and who is actually tracking people. So the next few slides, what you're going to see is, so to say, bleeding edge research, which means the graphs are maybe not easy to read and not as polished as we wanted to, but they give you a general idea of our findings. So the first thing you see here is who are the most prevalent trackers. So what are really the companies that track you the most? And if you look at this this table on the right-hand side upper corner, you see that Google is really the biggest player in the game. So it's Google Analytics, Google's ad provider, DoubleClick, and so on. Facebook is also very popular. And the graphs basically show you why, for us, it made sense to really analyze a big sample. So some researchers previously, they analyzed, I don't know, the top 100 websites. So really wanted to have a big sample. And as you can see here with a small spike, Baidu obviously is in Asian in Asia has a bigger market share. Yeah, so you see that some of the Google services are declining, while Baidu for some popular websites is a bigger player. The other thing, and this is unfortunately a table which is very hard to read, maybe with the huge projector it is, the thing is, and this is really the top tracking domains, and we wanted to see how effective the different tools are. And to our surprise, or not to our surprise, actually, Ghostory is really really leading the field. Yeah, so you can see that. So yeah, the first column is like how many, if you don't use any extension, who is tracking you. And then with Ghostory, you can see that some of the domains go to 0%. Yeah, so Ghostory is effectively blocking the tracking domains. You might also notice that there are some domains which Ghostory doesn't block. This is, for example, APIs, so font APIs from Google, so third-party content which you can't easily block, but which is also not really tracking you. So this was all kind of setting the stage for the last part I want to talk about this. So I showed you all these extensions, and what I really want to do, or what we want to do in this project, is make tracker blocking a little bit more usable, and I'm going to talk about certain drawbacks but also advantages of this solution. And yeah, and this project is called the Usable Privacy Box, or UBRI Box in short. It's an open source project, I was very lucky to get funding by the Internet Foundation in Austria. The funding is called NetID. And so the idea is to use a commodity hardware, so basically a Raspberry Pi with a Wi-Fi dongle, and make some kind of privacy-enhanced Wi-Fi hotspot, and make it as zero config as possible. Yeah, why the Raspberry Pi? I don't know. It's like, I think this Raspberry Pi hype always goes in cycles, and I have so many geek friends who bought, like, I don't know, 5 Raspberry Pis, and now they're just lying at home. Unused, or maybe you're using it to watch television or something with your media center set up. I really want you, once the software is out, take your Pi off the shelf and put our software on. So would be very happy if people gave it a try. The first prototypes, on the left side, this is on my desk back in St. Pölten. On the right-hand side, this was at Leiwandwil in MetaLab. This is where I stayed at the camp. It's a very awesome village. If you have time, go by there and check it out. And yeah, basically just use some cable binders to deploy my hotspot there. You could also try it out if you wanted to. We actually want to go next is want to create a nice case and actually work on the software, which brings me to the next point. What is it actually doing? So it's first of all it's blocking trackers. So I'm using some kind of DNS blacklist. Which redirects certain domains. So, for example, Google Analytics is resolved by the Ubrepox and redirected to a different host, and it resets the cookies from this tracking domain. So, basically, you connect to the Wi-Fi once, and you also get rid of some old cookies. It also uses a transparent proxy called Privoxy. I guess most of you know the project. If not, Google it. It's quite nice. It's maintained by some German developers. This also injects CSS into the website, so advertising is not displayed. And what I ultimately want to do is block advertising and tracking in on websites and also in applications on your mobile phone. Yeah? So if you connect your mobile phone, I want these little tracking ads to be gone. Network blocking, though, is tricky. Yeah. So, I mean, the network blocking, the nice thing is you connect to the Wi-Fi and most of the trackers are gone. So it works with most of the devices which have Wi-Fi. So if you're old feature phone with Wi-Fi, it works the same way as with your Android or iPhone. However, it's not very easy or it's quite tricky to do network blocking. For one, you can't reliably detect third parties. If you have a browser extension, this is something which you can easily do, like Privacy Badger does. This is very tricky to do on the network. The other thing is, and this is might be a privacy paradoxon, or at least for my project, is the growing number of websites which are using DLS or HTTPS by default. Which is very good because you don't leak any information, but obviously the box can't intercept it. It would be a very, very bad idea for a privacy project to open up the HTTP traffic. So this is something I'm definitely not doing. So certain trackers are harder to block. So for example, this Facebook like button. Because it's all encrypted and it's on the same domain, the tracking is on the same domain as the main Facebook website, you can't just block the domain, yeah? I would love to, but then people would get annoyed if they want to surf their Facebook account. The other thing is onion routing with Tor. We decided to deactivate this feature. It works quite nice, so it filters advertisement and you route your whole traffic over Tor. The thing though is there's no magic Tor boxes. Yeah, you're always gonna screw up if you're using one of these privacy boxes with Tor on them because it's just a very, very bad idea. So what we do is like we point the people to download the Tor browser bundle. What I personally think is the most effective way to block trackers and to increase your privacy. So never ever if you're doing something critical, never ever use your normal browser and just route it over the Tor network. The last thing the Ubrepox is gonna offer is a VPN. So it comes with OpenVPN, certificate based. We spent quite some time on trying to get IPsec running. There might be some network guys among you here. I just literally hated it working with it. But OpenVPN is very nice, and so you can use the box even when you're abroad. So I guess the CCC camp would be a good option to use a VPN because of, all your colleagues and the friendly neighbor hacker. The issues here, or the challenges, is zero config is tricky to set up. So you have to somehow do the port forwarding with UPnP or NAT BNP, And of course, you have to handle changing or dynamic IPs by your provider somehow. Yeah, the plan for the project is that we release it on GitHub. Using a configuration management tool called Ansible. So you can really reproduce the image, and we want to release it in the end of this year. And yeah, there are many, many gifted students and people helping me, so I'm not doing this by myself. There's Aaron, Alex, and Anton who are doing mostly the networking stuff and the hardening. Julian and Tobias are two bachelor students at FH Sankt-Pölten, who are really good programmers and really obsessed with security as well, so we always have interesting discussions. And I also have some usability people and some people helping me with the case. So basically, I'm very happy to work with a small team of people to get this done. Yeah. This brings me basically to my final slide, the takeaways from this presentation. So, just in a nutshell, I think we are now entering basically an arms race between trackers and blockers. So, AdBlock Plus, for example, had a legal case in Germany now because by blocking advertisement, of course, it's also you're creating problems for publishers because they lose revenue. And so they were suing some German news companies were suing AdBlock Plus, for example. A former Google employee wants to create a new company now which works in the opposite direction of browser extensions, where he wants to come up with tracking and advertisement methods which are harder to block. Yeah. So I think that's really a lot of things are happening there. Basically, I think the browser extensions, to some extent, to my surprise, are quite effective. As said, I would go with uBlock. Disconnect is also very nice, and Privacy Badger. These three applications come all with an open source license, which is really nice. And then finally, I talked about this usable privacy box project I'm working on, where the goal is really to make the whole thing zero config, so you don't have to install a browser extension on every browser you use. You don't have to configure it and make sure you enable blocking in Ghostory and disable the feature where you send statistics called Ghost Rank back to Ghostory, where you don't have to fiddle with AdBlock Plus to disable acceptable ads and so on. So basically something I could also give to my parents at home and they connect their devices and they are happy. And as I said, if you have a spare Raspberry Pi, I really hope you could turn it into a Uribox and give it a try. And yeah, the last one this is an obvious thing for everyone who ever programmed. Prototyping is very easy, productive setup is hard, yeah? This is not the usable privacy box, there are so many tutorials. So if you check out Adafruit, they have an Onion Pi, there's an Adafruit Wi-Fi advertising blocker and so on. If you want to go from these small how-tos to something really, I don't know, more stable and useful, that's tricky. But also that's not a surprise, but just to let you know, we're working hard on the box. If you want to stay tuned for the public release, this is the Twitter account at Usable Privacy. If you don't have the chance to speak with me today, you can always contact me for questions. Actually, there's a typo here, so it should be .org. Yeah, thank you for listening, and hopefully you learn something new and you have some interesting questions.
Thank you very much, Markus Huber, for your talk. As we are running short on time, please, only one or two short questions. If you have more questions, please meet each other outside of the tent. I think it's okay for you to meet.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, one or two questions only, please, from the left.
Just one question. Do you have tried some combination like NoScript on one of these tools?
There's NoScript and request policy. I think it's what most people here at the camp use, but I think it's just not accessible to the average person. So the whole thing for me, it's also a usability idea. I know most people here are fond of NoScript. It's effective, but anybody not from the camp would have a hard time using it. Yeah. So this is why we didn't include it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Did this answer your question? Or?
I wonder if you had any advice for publishers who are relying on advertising to fund their sites. Obviously, the revenue from targeted ads is much higher than revenue from ads that are just generally broadcast on the internet. And I wondered if you could, if you had any advice for them.
I didn't really get the question. The question was about revenue and advertisement? Or?
Yeah, so for advice for publishers, so people who are trying to keep their site running on advertising revenue. It's obviously in their interest to have targeted ads on their website because they get more revenue than they will ads for non-targeted.
That's true. And I see a real problem here, especially, I mean, some open source or grassroots campaigns also relying on advertisement to basically fund their project. I think one really nice idea is like things like micropayment systems like Flutter or something where you can directly donate to the website and you just Flutter websites. But I think it's a very bad idea if you run your website that you do enable tracking enable tracking of people. For bigger media houses, I'm afraid that once people effectively block advertisement, it's gonna be like movies nowadays. It's gonna be news with product placement. So you are basically reading a news article which is funded by a company, and it looks like normal news to you. So this is. With movies and TV, we got rid of all the advertisement. Now you're watching a movie cluttered with products. Yeah. So, and I think that's for one thing. But for smaller websites, I would go for crowdfunding, Flutter, or get Bitcoin donations, PayPal donations, something like this. But not rely on advertisement.
So for more questions, please. Meet Markus outside of the tent because we're running out of time. Thank you again very, very much, Markus Huber.